Yeah. You ready? Hey. Let's go. Bet.
How do you guys remember what series we're on? Fear. Fear. That's right. Fear. Well, I'm gonna tell some stories to start off the night that don't necessarily have anything to do with fear, but you guys will understand the reasoning for them here in a second. These stories that I'm telling, they're about people, voices, I guess, if you will, in our life that have caused me to make some poor decisions. Actually, no. You know what? First of all, before we get started, we got to sing happy birthday to two people. So, we've got two very special people. One of their birthdays was today. The other one's birthday is tomorrow, right? Tomorrow? All right. Tommy DeClue, his birthday is today. Yeah. Yeah, he turns 19 today. And no, I'm just kidding. But Tommy's birthday is today, and we have Caitlin, 20, and her birthday is tomorrow. Where is she? There she is. Yeah, and they both love this. Yeah, so we're going to sing them happy birthday to Tommy and Caitlin, all right? There we go. One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Tommy and Caitlin. Happy birthday to you. Yeah. All right. Here, back to stories of me making bad decisions. All right. So when I was in college, and by the way, I wrote out like 8 optional stories because I've been here for like 4 years and I can't remember what stories I have and haven't told. So if I'm telling a story and I've told you on a Wednesday, let me know, all right? And I'll go to another one. But I think these ones are all new for a Wednesday. So have I told you the story about where I tore the tendon in my hand? Did I say that on a Wednesday? No? All right. How many of you guys have not heard the story about it? Oh, okay. All right. Most have. Okay. So when I was a freshman in college at Evangel, Goose represent, we played intramural football and we were terrible. And it was flag football, but I grabbed onto someone's like flag belt, I guess, and it tore a tendon in my hand, all right? Like, I knew it was torn, like, my finger got all puffed up and black. I couldn't bend it at all. But I had a buddy who was on my floor, and he is dumb. He was one of my good friends, but he's really dumb. And he told me, he's like, I was like, dude, Noah, I think I tore a tendon in my hand because, like, it's messed up, right? I was like, you know, I can, like, feel it down here in my hands, and, like, it was like this, like I couldn't bend my finger at all. He's like, nah, bro, you're fine. I was like, no, seriously, like feel it. And he like grabs my hand. He's like, nah, dude, you're good, trust. He's like, my mom tore a tendon one time in her leg. He's like, so I know. And I'm like, are you sure? He's like, yeah, man, just trust me. Just like give it some time, it'll heal. I'm like, okay. So, you know, a week passes, 2 weeks pass, a month passes, a month and a half passes. It's like 2 months later and I still can't move my finger at all. And Noah's like, dude, like, quit being a wuss, you know? Like, it'll be fine. I'm like, you know what? I think I'm actually going to go to the doctor. So I'm home for Thanksgiving break. I tore my tendon, like, the second week of school, and it's Thanksgiving. So, like, literally 2 months later, I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to go to the doctor. So I go to the doctor, and I'm like, hey, I think I tore a tendon on my finger because I can't move it, you know? Like, it's not getting any better. And she's like, okay, like, hold your hand out. She grabs onto my ring finger. She's like, all right, try and bend it. She's like, try and bend it. I'm like, I am. She's like, oh. And then she like starts rubbing around on my hand. And she's like, oh, yeah, no, you definitely tore it. She's like, when did you do this? I'm like, 2 months ago or so. She's like, you're just now going to the doctor? I'm like, yeah. She's like, why'd you wait so long? I'm like, well, you know, one of my buddies told me I was fine, and, you know, I didn't tear it. And she's like, don't ever listen to that friend again. She's like, you took so long, so now you're not going to have full mobility in that finger anymore. I'm like, bummer. there's one story. I know I've told some of you guys this story, but I think it was at my house or something. I don't think it was on a Wednesday, so most of you guys don't know it. Did I tell you guys the story about me shining the laser in someone's eyes, my military-grade laser? Okay. So I don't think Pastor Logan was in my cabin at camp for this year. When I was in high school, I bought this from like some sketchy Chinese website. I bought this laser that could light stuff on fire. It was like really powerful. And I brought it to camp. And this is just preface. Illinois camp is so tame compared to Minnesota camp. So I'm in this cabin again with some more dumb people. We had so much fun. And there was this guy that was on night watch. His name was Chris. Start with a C. I'm not gonna say his name. We didn't like him. He was mean. All right. He was a mean guy. He just had like a big ego, and he took night watch way too seriously. And we're like, we're gonna teach this guy a lesson, you know? So we're in our cabin after lights out. And Jackson, I said his name. Jackson had this brilliant idea. He's like, yo, like shine that laser in Mr. Seaman's eyes. I'm like, are you sure? Like, dude, it might make him go blind. He's like, nah, do it. You know, we don't like him. I'm like, okay. So he's like sitting on his golf cart outside the Geneva Java, and I'm like shining it out there in the window, and he's like, and then him and another night watch guy like come in our cabin, and we see him coming, so we all like jump in bed and pretend we're asleep. And he's like, who's got the laser? And we all just pretend that we're asleep. And we're like, he's like, I know you guys are awake. I saw you guys shining it. And we're like, what? What are you talking about? And he's like, don't do that. He's like, you can make people go blind. He's like, that's really messed up. And we're all just like, okay, like, you know, if he just yells at us, like, we're good. You know, like, we got off clean. Well, my buddy Jackson, he's known to run his mouth. All right, he's got him in trouble a lot of times. And as Mr. Seaman is walking out the door, he says something to him that I can't repeat. He like talks trash, and he's like, "What'd you say?" And Jackson's like, "He's like nothing," and he's like, "Don't make me come back or whatever." So he like walks out. As he like gets back in his golf cart, Jackson's like, "Do it again, do it again." I'm like, dude, like, no, we're gonna get in big trouble, you know? And he's like, "No, do it, do it." I'm like, you do it. So I like hand him the laser, and then he's out there shining it through the window into his eye. This time, Mr. Seaman, you know, we called him Crustacean. That wasn't his name. So I'll just say, so Crustacean comes back in. He's even more mad this time. And Jackson just gets right to smack talking. All right, he's like calling him names and like saying all these things. Jackson's on the bunk above me. So I'm just like laying in bed like, oh my gosh, we're gonna get so much trouble. He again says more things to him that I can't repeat that were not good. Jackson at this time was not a Christian, so you have to keep that in mind. So he's saying these things, and then Crustacean goes to like grab him and tries to like rip him out of the bed. And I'm just like, Jackson, get naked. He can't touch you if you're naked. So Jackson starts taking off his clothes, gets butt naked, jumps down in the room, and he's like, what's up? Are we gonna go? And then Crustacean's like, he's like, you guys are messed up. He's like, I'm getting Mark. Mark Dean was the district youth director at the time. So Jackson's just standing there, no shame, just like, what's up? Let's go, man. Like butt naked in front of everyone. We ended up, you know, Mark came over and he's like, what's going on? And Jackson's like, he tried to assault me. And then Crustacean's like, well, he got naked. And then Mark's like, what is going on? He's like, all right, like, both you guys just like knock it off. We're gonna like pretend this didn't happen. We're gonna like, you know, whatever. So that happened. Again, he told me to shine the laser in his eyes. Bad idea. Listen to a bad voice. And then I'll tell one more story. I know I haven't told this, but some of you guys, if you've been around for a while, you got to experience this live. So if you guys remember the old basement, right? Like a block down. You guys remember how hot it used to get in there? Dude, it got hot in there, especially in the summer. So I remember there was, T-Bird knows where I'm going with this. So the AC could never, ever keep up. I would crank it down to like 55 degrees during the day, and then it would like be 85 like the second you guys walked in there. I remember there was one night where we were going down there for sound check, and it still should have been cold in the room, and it was hot. And I'm like, oh no, if it's already hot, it's gonna be miserable. So I walk into the back closet. I'm like, is the AC not working? Like, what's going on? And I open up the panel, and it's literally just like a big chunk of ice. Like, you can't see anything. It's literally just a big block of ice. I'm like, oh no, this isn't good. And where's Haley rinsing at? Yeah. So Haley's back there, and I'm like, Haley, like, what do we do? And Nick was there, and Haley's like, I don't know. She's like, maybe we try and like scrape it off or something. I'm like, that's a good idea. I'm like, what do I use? And she's like, you have like a screwdriver or something? I'm like, as a matter of fact, I do. I do have a screwdriver. And I'm like, no, that's a really good idea, Haley. I'll chip the ice off and I'll save the day. Nick's like, I don't know, man. I don't know if you should stab the AC unit with a screwdriver. I'm like, dude, like, it's like I gotta do something, all right? Like the ship's going down, like I gotta put out this fire, you know? And so I'm sitting there and I'm chipping at it with the screwdriver, and I'm like, oh, I'm making progress, you know, maybe the AC will start working again. Nick's like, I really wouldn't do that. And then gas starts shooting out. Nick like, gas. Nick runs out. I'm like, get back here, you wuss. Like, just a little bit of gas. You know, I don't know anything about AC units. So the room like fills up with gas. Haley's like, oh crap, you know. And I'm like, I think I just made it worse. So anyways, and then Nick like calls his dad, and Jason's like, evacuate the building. You're all gonna die from the poisonous gas. I'm like, Nick, settle down. We're all going to be fine. And Nick's like, no, dude, like, we really could all die. Like, it's on you, you know, if we all die. I'm like, chill out. Jesus is with us. We're not going to die. I did, in fact, stab through the thingy. What's it called, Tommy? I stabbed through the evaporator. Tommy, certified HVAC tech, blue-collar boy. I love that. So I stabbed through that. Should I tell one more or should I move on? One more? Okay. I'm pretty sure I told you guys about, like, when I was in high school and I used to, like, go drifting with friends when it snowed out. Have I told that story? I think I have. Okay. Let's see. I could do... did I tell you guys about the albino farm in Springfield? Okay. Based on the fact that all you guys are like, what? I can't remember if I ever took Goose the albino farm or not. Like, on the south side? Off James River Freeway in 65. Okay, so I used to like to go to abandoned buildings that were like sketchy and scary because it was fun. One of the places that I used to go to, or no, this was the abandoned Girl Scout camp. I took my brother Owen, my cousin Mitchell, and Jacob Wilcox Logan. They came down to Evangel. None of them actually. Like, we're planning on going to Evangel except for Owen. They just wanted to come down and do hood rat stuff. So I take them. We have to, like, walk, like, a mile through the woods to get to this place. And, you know, we go there because, like, you hear, like, sketchy stuff happens or whatever. So, you know, you're kind of, like, hoping for it. So we're, like, walking through these, like, this abandoned building. And we go down into the basement. And I'm, like, going down the steps, right? And obviously it's, like, the middle of the night. So you can only see, like, as far as your phone flashlight goes. And this was, like 6 or 7 years ago when phone flashlights weren't quite as good as they are now. So I can only see like 5 feet in front of me. So I'm like going down the steps in this sketchy building, and I get down to the bottom and I go to turn off the steps. And as I shine my phone flashlight over here, I look down and there's a man sleeping right there as I'm taking a step. So I go, and I look down and I like hold my phone flashlight up so it's not like shining in his eyes. Cause if you shine a flashlight in someone's eyes, they're gonna like wake up. And I'm like, and I, like, look back up the stairs, and the other three are coming down, and I have to, like, signal to them to stop or don't make any noise without me making any noise. So I turn around, and I'm like, and they're like, there's a man. So I, you know, I'm like, you know, and then you tiptoe back up the stairs. That time I was the bad voice telling them, oh, we should go and do this sketchy thing, you know, and we ended up getting out. Like, he didn't, like, chase us or anything that time, so, yeah, well, earlier in the night, we got chased out of the vampire tunnels, so we went there, but, so here we go. We're gonna lock in now. These stories have a meaning. The voices in your life that you listen to are very, very important. Let me tell you something. Your walk with God, I'm gonna bring it in now. Your walk with God will go a lot better if you listen to the right voices. If you listen to the wrong voices, it will hinder your success. You will get yourself into trouble. Bad things will happen. It will hinder your success. The voices you listen to will determine your success or your failure. So tonight, again, we are on our series on fear. I want to talk to you guys tonight about the fear of voices. the fear of voices in your life. Voices from the enemy, voices in your head, maybe voices from someone at school, voices from maybe a friend or a family member. You know, it basically boils down to the fear of what people say about you, or the fear of what people say to you, or maybe just the fear of the voices that you hear in your head. You know, I've had so many conversations with so many of you who have said things like, you know, I'm afraid to do this because people say this about her, people say this about me, or I'm afraid to do this because I've got these thoughts that are going in my head, I got these voices in my head, or, you know, people are telling me to do this, or people are telling me to do that, or people are telling me to go right here, or people are telling me to go left here. You know, I don't know what to do. I don't know what God's plan is for my life. Or I do know what God's plan is for my life, but I've got these voices in my head that are discouraging me, that are telling me I shouldn't do it for this reason or that reason. You know, and what I want for you guys tonight is to be able to discern the bad voices from the good voices in your life. So tonight we're going to read out of Nehemiah. Say Nehemiah.
Nehemiah.
Nehemiah. So we're going to look at the wrong voices and the right voices in the book of Nehemiah. Now, let me give you guys a little bit of background story on the book of Nehemiah. So, King Nebuchadnezzar, say Nebuchadnezzar.
Nebuchadnezzar.
Names are so much cooler back then than they are now. He was the king of Babylon, and what happens is he goes into Jerusalem and he destroys the city. He burns down the homes, he destroys the temple, he tears down the walls, and he takes all of the Israelites into slavery. In Israel, they're in pain and bondage for a season, and then years later, a remnant of Israel, and a remnant's like a small group of people that are led by Zerubbabel. Say Zerubbabel. Led by Zerubbabel and Ezra. And when they got back, they rebuilt the temple of God. So years later, a small group of people, they went back and they rebuilt the temple. You know, and it was great and stuff. But the thing is, you know, what good is it to rebuild the temple if you don't have any sort of walls protecting the city? Because you have to realize in that day and age, you needed to have walls to protect your city, to protect your country, to protect your home. They had no protection. And so now Israel, they're back in their homeland. They rebuilt the temple, but they're in a place of weakness because there's no fortified walls. They're living in shame. And what Nehemiah does, he hears about that remnant that goes back to Israel. And then he asks the king, he asks King Nebuchadnezzar, love that name. He asks King Nebuchadnezzar if he can go back and he can rebuild the wall, and the king, he grants him the permission to do that, and he's like, yeah, you know, you can go back, and you'll be safe while you're doing that. And what happens is Nehemiah, he gets back to the city, and, you know, to go rebuild the wall around the city, and then he begins to hear some negative voices, and they begin to tell him things like, don't rebuild that wall, you know, and you know, they start telling him things like, no, don't do God's will, don't do God's plan. And what Nehemiah had to do is he had to mute the negative voices and listen to the positive voices. So I want to ask, how many of you guys have ever like had to FaceTime like a grandparent or like someone who's really old, not very tech savvy? Okay, so mostly everyone. My grandparents, they don't have iPhones, they have Androids. So when I FaceTime them, I have to use this thing called WhatsApp, which is like something that's big in other countries, but like nobody in the United States has it unless they've been to another country. So there was this one time where my grandma and grandpa were trying to WhatsApp video call me. And I remember I was on the phone with them and, you know, I see them and, you know, and I see that they're trying to talk, but I can't hear anything. Or no, sorry, I take that back. I can hear them, but I can see that they like can't hear me. They're like, you know, like, and I'm like, what's going on? Like, why can't you hear me? And I was like getting really frustrated because I just automatically assumed it was their fault. I'm like, oh my gosh, you old people, you're so bad with technology. And I'm getting all mad, and they're like, we can't hear you. And I'm like, it's your fault. And you know, I'm getting really mad. I'm getting ready to just like hang up. I'm like, I'm done with this. And I looked out and I had the mute button pressed on WhatsApp because it like the interface is different than FaceTime. I had them muted. And let me tell you guys, there are some people in your life that you need to hit the mute button on. There are some, maybe it's a friend, maybe it's someone sitting next to you right now, maybe it's a brother or sister, maybe it's someone at school. You guys gotta learn how to press the mute button on some voices in your life. You guys know what I'm talking about? Turn to your neighbor and say, mute. 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 You know, the reality is a lot of the reason why you have these negative voices in your life, you know, specifically regarding to you walking out God's calling on your life is because they're just angry that the truth that you speak contradicts the lie that they live. So I'm going to speak to you guys tonight about four kinds of negative voices that we can have in our life. And we're going to get those from the book of Nehemiah. The first sign that I want you guys to get is negative voices ridicule you when you try to do God's will. Negative voices ridicule you when you try to do God's will. Picking up in Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1, it says, when Sanballat, say Sanballat, when Sanballat heard that they were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates in the army of Samaria, he said, what are those feeble Jews doing? Will they restore their wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from those heaps of rubble, burned as they are? Tobiah the Ammonite, who was at his side, said, what are they building? Even a fox climbing up on it would break down their wall of stones. Now listen, God has clearly spoken to Nehemiah to do something here. But let me tell you something. Just because God calls you to do something, even if it's so clear, like you're like, no, I heard the voice of God telling me to do this. Just because God's calling you to do something does not mean you're not going to face opposition. In fact, it's the complete opposite. Just because God's calling you to do something doesn't mean that it's going to be easy. Doesn't mean that you're not going to face hardship. Doesn't mean that you're not going to have people in your ear the entire time ridiculing you, trying to tell you to stop. In fact, it says in Matthew chapter 10, verse 22, it says, this is Jesus talking, you will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. You know, these were people who were angry that Nehemiah was doing the will of God, so they bullied him and they harassed him. And let me tell you how you can recognize a negative voice in your life. They're always going to be ridiculing you. They're always going to be tearing you down. They're always going to be telling you that you're not enough. They're going to be telling you that it's dumb. They're going to be telling you all of these things, you know. And some of you guys, you're fighting an insecurity, or you're fighting this battle where God has spoken to you and asked you to do something. Whatever that may be, I believe that every single one of us, God has put a call on our life. And, you know, you'll have people, you know, whether it's the voices in your head, it's the enemy speaking to you, maybe it's someone at school or someone at home, and they say things like, you know, you need to stop with this. You're not smart enough. You're never going to succeed. You're not good enough. You know, you're dumb. If you mess up, everyone's just going to make fun of you. Like, who do you even think you are? Like, this is just so outrageous and so dumb, and they're going to put all these things in your mind. They're always going to ridicule you, and you got to learn how to hit mute on those voices and not listen to them. The second sign is negative voices create fear and doubt. Negative voices create fear and doubt. Moving forward into verse 10, it says, meanwhile, the people in Judah said, the strength of the laborers is giving out, and there is so much rubble that we cannot rebuild the wall. Also, our enemies said, before they know it or see us, we will be right there among them and will kill them and put the end to the work. Then the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times over, wherever you turn, they will attack us. I want you guys to notice the doubt. Notice the fear that's going on in the Israelites. You know, negative voices, they will create fear and doubt to try and keep you from doing what God has for your life. You know, and some of you guys are listening to those voices. You guys are letting that fear and you guys are letting that doubt creep into your life. You know, voices saying things like, it's not going to work. You know, I know you think that God told you that, but it's just foolish to even like consider that. Like, I know it's not going to happen. Everyone else knows it's not going to happen. You know, like, imagine how dumb you're going to look when you fail. They say things like that. And, you know, when you have a little fire in your life, they love to just come and dump water all over it. You guys know what I'm talking about? When you get excited, you know, you feel like God speaks to you. You're like, man, this is awesome. I'm going to go share this with someone. And then they just totally dump water on it. Or also, if, you know, they love to, you know, if you got the a little fire of fear and anxiety and doubts, they love to pour gasoline on it. They love to just fuel your fire. I mean, you guys know what I'm talking about. People who just like egg it on and they just build it up and they just make it worse and worse and worse. And they just feed into it, you know. And you got to learn, again, to hit mute on all the people that are putting fear and doubt in your life, who are saying things like, you're never going to be good enough. You know, your parents are never going to be proud of you. You've never had anyone who believes in you. No one ever will believe in you. You're always going to be a failure. How many of you guys have ever, let's just be real. How many of you guys have ever had voices like that in your head? Maybe not someone literally physically spoke it over you, but you've thought those thoughts in your head. You're like, man, you know, like I've messed up so many times. I'm going to mess up again. Man, people are going to, imagine what people are going to say about me when I fail. You know, I feel like God told me to start a Bible study. You know, it's never worked before. Like people are just going to make fun of me, whatever it may be. I want you guys to turn to your neighbor again and say, mute, mute. I can't hear you. The third sign of negative voices is negative voices will distract you from God's plan. Jumping up to chapter 6, it says, when the word came to Sanballat, Tobiah, Geshem the Arab, and the rest of our enemies that I had rebuilt the wall and not a gap was left in it, though up to that time I had not set the doors in the gates, Sanballat and Geshem sent me this message. Come, let us meet together in one of our villages in the plain of Ono. So these two men, they were trying to distract him from finishing the wall. They said, stop working. Stop, you know, just quit it. Stop working. Let's just talk. You know, and I want to ask you, who's distracting you from God's plan on your life? Who's distracting you from God's plan on your life? For some of you ladies, it might be a dude. Might be a dude, you know. He sees you and he hits you with one of those lines. Like, you know, if I were the alphabet, I would rearrange it so that you and I were together. You know, I wish I was cross-eyed so I could see you twice. Ooh. You know, or are you a magician? Because the craziest thing happens, whenever I see you, everyone else disappears. Ooh. Or, you know, I ought to complain to Spotify for you not being named this week's hottest single. Ooh. Boys, you better not use those. And for some of you dudes, it might be a girl. Let's just be real. Who's distracting you? Who's distracting you? The reality is, there's probably a lot of people in here. The person who's distracting you is sitting right next to you. They might be distracting you. You know, that's the reality. The person sitting next to you might be distracting you from paying attention while I'm preaching right now. I just saw a finger get pointed. The person sitting next to you might be the reason why you never will raise your hands in worship. The person sitting next to you might be the reason why you'll never pray. The person sitting next to you might be the reason why you'll never go up and ask a leader for prayer. Who's distracting you? Who's distracting you? Distracting you from seeking God, from serving, from getting closer to God? Who's distracting you from God's plan on your life? You know, and maybe it's unintentional voices. You know, maybe it's your sports team. Let me just ask, since when did football or volleyball or basketball become more important than God? I mean, let's just think about it, you know, and I hear all the excuses in the book. Oh, what will my coaches say? What will the people on my team say? I'm sorry, who are we trying to please? Who do we care more about pleasing? Are we going for the approval of man or the approval of God? You know, and I'm not telling this story to make myself sound like I'm sitting on a high horse, but listen, when I was in high school, I was on the varsity wrestling team, I was on the varsity football team, I was the commander of all my competitive JROTC teams, and none of them came before church. Pastor Logan can attest to this. Listen, at every single level, from middle school through high school, every single one of my coaches, my Army instructors in JROTC, they knew that at 6 o'clock on Wednesday night, whether practice was over or not, I was walking out and I was going to church. And it wasn't just me. We had a whole group. Listen, I remember, like, I got on our freshman football team. I guess my coach had, like, forgot or he assumed we were bluffing. But I'll never forget, like, the first Wednesday of the football season, our freshman year, there's a group of, like, 12 of us that were like, all right, coach, sorry, we're not running suicides. We're going to youth group. And he's like, what? Like, you can't do that. We're like, sorry, going to church. You know, like, take it up with my boss if you're upset. You know, and here's the thing. I'm not trying to say sports are bad, and I'm not trying to say you can never, ever miss a church service for a football game, or you never miss church for a volleyball tournament. But listen, I know how it goes. I know how it goes. You know, it's the same thing with work. But the reality is it always starts with, oh, it's just one Wednesday. Or, oh, it's just one Sunday. You know, and then before you know it, you haven't been to church in 3 months or 6 months. And you're like, man, you know, what happened? Why can't I sense the presence of God? Why is everything in my life falling apart? Listen, that's the reality. And again, I'm not saying sports or work is bad. It's good. But when what's good is distracting you from what's best, there's a problem. And maybe, and listen, I know there's people in here who get this and they're like, yeah, I agree. You know, and maybe this doesn't apply to you, but there's people that you know who should be here right now, but they're not here because of some sort of sport or some sort of extracurricular activity. And what you need to do after service tonight is you need to text that person, say, hey, you need to get your butt to church. Listen, you haven't been in a couple of weeks. You haven't been in a couple of months. You got to remember, you got to realize where your priorities are. Don't get distracted. Don't get distracted. Again, I'm not sitting here trying to, you know, sound like I'm on my high horse, but trust me, like if I could do it, if Pastor Logan could do it, you guys can do it too, all right? Number four, negative voices manipulate you. It says in chapter 6, verse 5 and 7, it says, then the fifth time. I want you guys to notice this, the fifth time. The reality is some people will just keep coming at you. Like if they don't distract you, if they don't get you to stop on the first time, they're going to come again and again and again and again. It says, now the fifth time, Sanballat sent his aid to me with the same message. In his hand was an unsealed letter in which was written, it is reported among the nations. And Geshem says, it is true that you and the Jews are plotting to revolt, and therefore you're building the wall. Moreover, according to these reports, you're about to become their king and have even anointed prophets to make this proclamation about you in Jerusalem. There's a king in Judah. Now, this report will get back to the king, so come, let us meet together. New Hope Youth, all of this was untrue. This was a bold-faced lie. Like, just straight up, not one bit of this was true. They were straight up lying to Nehemiah to try and get him to stop building the wall. They're like, oh, if we can make up this lie about him and we can give it to the king, then he's going to stop. You know, it's unfortunate, but the reality is there will be people in your life who will lie to you, who will lie about you to try and manipulate you from doing God's will. That's just the sad reality, guys. It happens to me. It has happened to me in the past. You know, people have lied about me in the past to try and keep me from doing God's will. You know, whether it was in high school and college, let me just say, like, it will happen to you at some point. If it hasn't already happened to you, it will happen to you. So don't let it surprise you. You know, people will see you walk on water and they'll say it's because you can't swim. You got to learn how to mute those voices. And also, this is just another thing, don't feel the need to address all those voices. If you know that someone's lying about you, don't feel like you need to defend yourself. Don't feel like you need to address every single thing. That's exactly what the enemy would like you to do. Stop it. Stop it. Don't do that. Because when you do that, you're distracted and it gets your attention off of what God's calling you to do. All right, you got to stop. You got to say, listen, I'm too busy. I'm working too hard at pursuing what God's calling me to do, what God's got for my life, that I'm not even going to waste my time addressing the people that are trying to stop me. You got to learn how to hit mute. Even though they may lie, even though they may try and manipulate, don't give in. You got to hit mute. All right, now we're going to switch it up a little bit. And I want to tell you guys about positive voices in your life, because even though it's just as important to learn how to mute those negative voices and not listen to those and not give in, positive voices are so important. We all need them in our life. The first thing is positive voices help you to overcome fear and doubt. Jumping back to chapter 4, it says, after I looked things over, I stood up and said to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people, don't be afraid of them. Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your families, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your homes. Listen, guys, you need some people in your life who are going to tell you, don't be afraid of them. You need people in your life. When God is calling you to do something and it's so clear and you've got, and there's people who are trying to tear them down and people who are trying to get them to stop, you need people in your life who are going to say, don't listen to them. Who cares what they say? Who cares what the people at school are going to say about you? Who cares what your brother or sister is going to say about you? Who cares what the voices in your head maybe are telling you, or what the enemy's trying to trick you into believing? Who cares what they say? Don't listen to them. Do you guys have someone like that in your life? You know, I think the reason why Pastor Logan and I have been friends for so long, even though we lived 9 hours away from each other, is because we did this for each other growing up. We did this for each other in middle school and high school and college and even still. All right, Pastor Logan has been one of my biggest encouragers. And so many times, like, I've gone to him when I've had doubts or I've had fears, and he's spoken life over me. He spoke truth into that situation. He's encouraged me. He's built me up. He's like, don't give in to that fear. Listen, you guys need to have people in your life who are going to do that. If you don't have one, you need to find someone. And this is a great place to find a friend like that. And if you do have a friend like that, you need to listen to them. All right? You got to have those kind of voices in your life. The second thing, positive voices remind you to remember the Lord. In the same verse, I want to highlight this. It says, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord, who is great and awesome. Listen, you need to have some voices in your life who are going to tell you to remember the Lord. When you feel like a loser, when you feel like you're weak, when you feel like you're a failure, when you feel like you can't do it, you know, when people are talking negative about that, you need someone who's going to say, yeah, you know, maybe, yeah, you're not enough on your own, but you've got God on your side. God is strong. Remember the Lord. Remember that if God is for you, who can be against you? Remember that if God spoke it, you will see it. You know, you need people who are going to speak that. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, it says, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. That's why, for Christ's sake, I would delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Is there anyone in here who's ever felt weak before? You're like, I just don't have what it takes in this situation. All right, so we got a couple people in the room. Everyone else is like, nah, I'm ready for anything. Nothing can stop me. Well, if you raise your hand, if you ever felt weak, then you're the perfect candidate for God to work through you. You're the perfect candidate. Number three, positive voices tell you to fight for God's promises. Positive voices tell you to fight for God's promises. Again, in the same verse, just highlighting a different part of it, it says, who is great and awesome, and fight for your families, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your homes. Listen, you need to have some people in your life who are going to speak this over you. They're going to say, no, you need to fight for the promises of God. You need to fight for what God has for you. You know, and some people think that Christians just need to be passive. You're like, oh, the Bible says turn the other cheek and, you know, never argue with anyone. And, you know, even though that's correct in the right context, listen, if you want to rebuild the wall, if you want to accomplish what God has for you, if you want to experience the fullness of what God has for your life, then you got to learn how to fight. You got to stop being passive, wussy Christians, and you got to learn how to fight for what God has spoke over your life. Listen, and I'm not saying that you need to be a jerk or you need to be nasty or rude, but you got to learn how to fight. You got to get some fire inside of you. You got to have some fight inside of you. That's the reason why it says in 2 Timothy, it says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Paul's saying he has fought the good fight. He had to fight. He had to be tough. Listen, you guys got to learn how to fight, guys. You got to get your spiritual weapons. You got to pull on the full armor of God, and you got to be willing to fight for what God has for you. Because you better believe the enemy does not want you to experience what God has for you. But you got to learn how to fight. Listen, you gotta say things like what Nehemiah is saying here. You know, I'm fighting for my family. Listen, I'm fighting for my brother. I'm fighting for my sister. I'm fighting for my friends at school. I'm going to fight. You got to have people who are going to tell you to fight, who are going to remind you to fight. The fourth thing, positive voices tell you to fight together. It says in verse 19 and 20, it says, then I wrote to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people. The work is extensive and spread out, and we are widely separated from each other along the wall. Wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us. Nehemiah said, we got to join together because our God will fight for us. Guys, one of the reasons why Christians lose many of their battles is because they try and fight the battle all on their own. They try and just fight the battle themselves. You know, God didn't call you to do all that. God didn't call you to do what you're supposed to do completely on your own. You know, and I'm not going to read all this scripture because I'm trying to be sensitive to time, but it says in this story that the persecution and the slander, and the people were trying to stop them so much that they literally said, like, hey, like, we're going to kill you and we're going to fight you so that way you stop building the wall. It got so bad that literally half the people building the wall, it said that they had to stop building the wall, and it said that they had to pick up shields and swords and spears and bows, and they had to guard the other people while they were building the wall. So it said half of them were building the wall and half of them were standing guard. And listen, you guys need to have a friend in your life who's going to say, I know that God put this on your life. I'm going to stand and I'm going to fight off the enemy. I'm going to fight for you. You need to have friends who are going to do that for you, and you need to do that for your friends. Do you guys have a friend in your life who's like, yeah, I'm going to go to bat for you. I'm going to fight for you. I'm going to put on my armor of God, and I'm going to go to battle for you. You know, maybe not literally with a sword and a spear, but it's like, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to fast for you. I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to speak the truth over your life. You need to have people in your life. You need to have positive voices in your life who's going to do that. Listen, you need your youth fam. You need community. That's the reason why we do life groups, guys. We don't do life groups just to check off a box. We don't do life groups just to say, yeah, we do life groups. That's not the reason why we do it. Listen, we do life groups because we want to be in battle for each other. We want to be able to pray for one another. We got to know when a brother or a sister is going through a battle, when they're trying to do something like, hey, the enemy's really coming against me. Hey, I'm really feeling discouraged. I really feel like people are saying this about me and I want to give up. And you got to have people in your life group who are going to say, no, I'm going to pray for you. No, I'm going to go to bat for you. I'm going to stand alongside you for however long it takes, and I'm going to go to battle for you. Listen, that's why it's important that we go to life groups. Next Tuesday night, boys are right here. Girls are at the Falk's house. High school girls are at my house. Get to a life group. Nehemiah says, join us. We're going to fight together. Number 5, positive voices tell you to pray. Chapter 6, verse 9, it says, they were all trying to frighten us, thinking their hands will get too weak for the work and they will not be completed. But I prayed. I love that. Their hands will get too weak for the work and it will not be completed. But I prayed. Now strengthen my hands. Listen, guys, we've got to pray. We've got to pray. And I can't say this enough. I can't emphasize this enough. If you want a breakthrough in your life, you have to pray. You have to pray. Guys, again, We don't do things on Wednesday nights. We don't do things in this youth group just to check off a box. There's a reason why we do pre-service prayer. 6 o'clock every Wednesday, here before service, we have pre-service prayer. Listen, there are victories in your life that you will only experience if you pray. There are things that God wants to do in your life that unless you pray, you are not going to experience them, period. Listen, this is a theme. This is doctrine all throughout the Bible. Unless you pray, you are not going to experience that. Again, this is the reason why we have pre-service prayer at 6. And if you don't want to go alone, if it's intimidating, then you got to turn to someone and say, hey, come with me to pre-service prayer. Let's go together. Let's do that. Guys, it's so important. You've got to pray. You've got to pray. And number 6, positive voices tell you to stay on the wall until the work's completed. Positive voices tell you to stay on the wall until the work's completed. I'm going to invite the worship team on up, and Pastor Logan, if you'd grab that. It says in verse 2 and 4 of chapter 6, it says, Sanballat and Geshem sent me this message, come let us meet together in one of the villages on the plain of Ono. But they were scheming to harm me, so I sent the messengers to them with this reply, I am carrying on a great work and cannot go down. Why should the work stop while I leave it and go down to you? 4 times they sent me the same message, and each time I gave them the same answer. You know, the reality is, and I'm going to use this ladder as an illustration, guys. And just imagine this ladder is a wall. Imagine I'm Nehemiah climbing on this wall. And this can be anything that's in your life. Say God spoke to you to do something. Say God put on your heart that you're supposed to go start a Youth Alive club at your school. Or say God told you that, you know, you're supposed to You're supposed to reach out to your family. Say your parents aren't Christian and God's like, hey, I want to use you to share the gospel with your family or whatever it may be. Or maybe God said, hey, I want you to do this sort of fundraiser where you're going to raise money for Speed the Light, where you're going to raise money to get girls, young girls and boys out of human trafficking or whatever it may be. You guys all know God is speaking to you. God has put something on your life. So what that looks like is you're on the wall. You're trying to do what God has put on your life. And if I could have Kirsten and Hannah come up for this. And if you guys have been a Christian for long enough, you guys will know exactly what I'm saying. So you're on the wall. You're trying to do what God's put on your heart. You're trying to do what God's got for you. And as you're on that thing, as you're climbing up higher and higher, and you're like, yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to accomplish the will of God. There's going to be people in your life. There's going to be maybe people at school. There's going to be maybe a brother or sister. There's going to be voices in your head that are trying to pull you down. Say, no, it's dumb. You got to give up. You're looking foolish right now. You're going to fail. You're not good enough. You've never been good enough. What you got to do is you got to say, mute, kick you in the face in the name of Jesus. You know, back off. I'm walking towards God's will. I'm going to climb this wall. I'm going to climb this wall. But at the same time, if you've ever tried to do something that's difficult in your life, maybe God spoke something over you. Maybe God put something on your heart. Maybe it was months ago. Maybe it was years ago, and you haven't seen it come to pass yet, because the reality is, a lot of times it can take a long time to build a wall. It can take a long time to do something that God put on your life, and then maybe you start giving into those voices. You're like, you know what? Yeah, that maybe I misheard God. Maybe this isn't God's will for my life. You know, that I kind of am looking dumb, because I shared that God put this on my heart, and it hasn't come to pass. You know, maybe I'm a fool, and you start going down the wall. You need people in your life who are going to stand behind you. Go ahead. We're going to stand behind you and say, no, you're not going to give up. No, we believe in you. No, we're going to pray for you. No, those people who are trying to tear you down, no, we're going to stand around behind you and we're going to go to bat for you. We're going to battle for you. We're going to pray for you. We're going to fast for you. And they're going to encourage you. And they're going to say, no, you got to stay on that wall. And then you start giving up again. And they're like, no, you're staying on that wall. You guys hear what I'm saying? All right. How about that for illustration? Thank goodness we had a ladder here. Listen, guys, if you guys would stand up on your feet. Thanks, Pastor Logan. You know, every single person in this room's got their own situation, and to try and act like we're all in the exact same boat with the call on our life, with our walk with God, would be foolish. We're all in different places. But I believe that there's people in here who have had this call placed on their life. God has spoke something over them. And they had voices in their life. They had someone, whether it was, you know, whoever it may be, they had some sort of negative voice in their life, and they gave up on it. They're like, you know what, that must just not be God's will for my life. I must have misheard. You know, I'm not the right one for the job. I'm not cut out for it. I'm not good enough. And you gave up on that call. I believe to those people in the room, God's speaking to you tonight, and he's saying, get back up on that wall. Get back on that wall. It's not done yet. I'm not done with you yet. Maybe there's people in this room right now and you're in the process. You're trying to fight the good fight. You're trying to do what God has put on your life, but you're on that wall right now. And there's all these voices. There's these negative voices that are speaking over you, and you're thinking about coming back down. You're thinking about giving up on what God has spoken over you. And what God's speaking to you tonight is, don't you get off that wall. Don't you get off that wall. And what you need to do tonight is you need to reach out to a friend. And you say, hey, I'm in a battle right now. I need you to fight for me. You got to humble yourself, quit acting like you're perfect, and you've got it all figured out, because no one is, and you got to reach out to someone. You got to go to a leader. You got to go to a friend. You got to say, hey, this is my situation. Can you help me? Can you fight for me? And maybe there's another group of people in here, and you've got a friend in this room, or there's someone in this room, and you know that they're in the middle of a battle, and they're thinking about giving up, or maybe they already have given up, and you need to be like Nehemiah's men that said, you're not getting off that wall. You're not giving up. God's not done with you yet. If God spoke it, you're going to see it. You got to stay on that wall. I'm going to fight for you. I'm going to go pray for you. Listen, I don't know every situation in this room, but I know that there's a lot of people in this room where you know something intimate. You know something that's going on in the life of someone in this room, and you need to go and you need to pray for them. You'd better go pray for them. Because you're a pretty bad friend, just being honest. So I'm just going to open up the room right now to let the Holy Spirit does what the Holy Spirit does, because he's God and I'm not. So if you need to go and ask someone for prayer, you need to do that. If you need to go and pray for someone, you need to do that. Whatever, if you just need to sit and soak in God's presence, whatever it may be, you need to go do that. Right now, I'm going to ask the leaders, if you guys could just kind of spread out throughout the room. It doesn't have to be at the front, just throughout the room on the outside to make yourselves available for prayer. But right now, we're just going to spend time in the presence of God in worship and prayer. And whatever you need to do, do it. But do not be a distraction. Right now, we're going to give time to God for him to do what he does best, all right? Can we do that? All right.